What's a dynamic disc? Hi everyone, Leo Notenboom here for askleo.com. If you've ever taken a look at Disk Manager, or maybe some of the other tools and utilities that are out there for managing your disk and your disk partitions, you may have seen the notification or the label of a disk as being either basic or dynamic. Most of the time, basic is all you need. It really is. You can have multiple partitions, you can boot from them, you can have them as additional drives on your system. Basic covers all the needs that most folks have. However, dynamic disks are at least interesting and can help with some odd situations. They tend to be used more in, I'll call them production environments, business environments, and even then not so much, but they are, like I said, interesting. So let's take a look at some of the examples and you'll be able to see what the differences are. The biggest difference is conceptual. You've probably heard of GPT, the grid partition table, or MBR, master boot record. These are two ways that disks are set up so that the operating system can know where all the different partitions on that disk are. GPT is the more powerful one. On a basic disk, there's just partitions. This one's here, that one's there, it's this big, that kind of stuff. With dynamic disks, the partition table is almost more of a database of complex information that actually allows us to do some really interesting things with partitions, pieces of partitions, multiple disks, and more. So let's start with a simple example. On a normal disk, on a basic disk, you often will see a scenario where you've got partition A, partition B, and some free space. Now, if we want to extend the space of partition B into that free space, it's not a problem. You just extend it. Windows will even do that for you. The really interesting part is, what do you do if you want to add that free space to partition A? Well, the first thing you have to do is actually rearrange the partitions. You actually need to move the free space so that it sits immediately after partition A. Once you've done that, you can extend partition A into the free space, and now you've got a bigger partition A with the original partition B. And indeed, many disk management tools will actually do exactly this. They will set it up so that they will move partitions around in order for you to accomplish whatever it is you're attempting to accomplish. In some cases, the Windows Disk Manager is enough. In many cases, especially when we're juggling partitions like this, it doesn't quite have all the capabilities we need and we end up going to a third-party tool. What if we have a dynamic disk? Well, in that case, rather than needing to move anything, all we really need to do is say that that free space is now the second part of partition A. So that means physically on the disk, we have the first part of partition A, partition B, and then the second part of partition A. Nothing had to be moved. We just had to say, yep, that's part of partition A. That's pretty neat, actually. There are pros and cons, as always, to techniques like this, but it's a quick way to be able to extend, so to speak, partition A without necessarily needing to move any data around. But it gets better. There's the concept of what's called a spanned volume. So let's say you have one disk, it's got a single partition on it. Once again, I'll call it partition A. But you want to add more space to your system, but you don't really want to add another drive letter. A spanned volume, as its name kind of implies, allows you to take a logical volume, like say your C drive, the partition that it represents, and span multiple drives. What that means then is that partition A, the first half of partition A, lives on the first physical disk, and the second half of partition A lives on the second physical disk. Now, the downside of this is you've doubled your risk of failure. If either of these hard drives fails or has a glitch, then the entire volume could be at risk. Even though that other disk may or may not have been affected by any of this, you actually are risking the whole thing. But It's a way to use disk space and not have to eat up a lot of drive letters. Another approach is what are called striped volumes. In this case, we're still using two drives, but instead of putting the first half of the data on one drive and the second half of the data on the other, now we actually break it up into chunks. And we might say the odd sections go on disk one and the even sections go on disk two. It's the same amount of space, it's just organized a little differently. Why would we want to do this? By spreading the data out a little bit more evenly, your reads can be faster. The disks will run faster because rather than focusing on one disk and hitting it very hard for, say, a specific file, some of that data will come from disk one, some of that will come from disk two. They're both going to be faster than whatever it is a single disk would do. So it's a speed optimization, but we still have the problem of doubling our risk of failure. Once again, if either of these disks fails, then we run the risk of losing the entire partition. Mirrored volumes are kind of sort of the opposite of stripe. You have a single partition, it's the size of a single disk, but the data for that partition is written to and read from both disks. In other words, one is a copy of the other all the time in real time. Why is this useful? Well, this, as it turns out, is again exactly the opposite of a stripe volume. You have at least halved, if not better, the impact of a failure. Many of systems that are set up this way are set up in such a way that if, say, disk one fails, well, A, you still got all your data on disk two, and sometimes you're actually able to replace drive A without turning off the machine and have the software magically recopy all the data so that you're back with this duplicate data and the machine never had to stop to make it happen. RAID 5 kind of sort of implements all of this. What you do is you end up with three disks. But the size you make available to the system is the size of two disks combined. The third disk is used as an error checking disk, so that if there's anything wrong with either disk one or disk two, the disk three notices, it's got the data that says there's something wrong. Then when you replace the broken drive, once again, the data on the first disk or whichever disk is still working, plus the error correction data, can be used to rebuild all of the data that was on that replaced drive. Why do we do this? Well, this is kind of sort of the best of both worlds. This is faster because you're spreading your data across multiple drives, and it's safer because you are protected from a single disk failure by this redundant information that allows you to essentially replace things more quickly. All of this, spanned, striped, mirrored, RAID, these are all things that require RAID 5. They can be implemented in Windows using Windows software only, and I believe they all require the NTFS file system be used. However, for most of this, you don't see this very often. The real reason is that in most situations where you really are looking for redundancy, resiliency, lack of downtime, that kind of stuff, systems will move to a RAID configuration, and there are multiple RAID configurations beyond RAID 5, but they do it not in software. They actually do it with a physical RAID controller, a card that these hard drives plug into that looks like a single drive to Windows, so you don't see any of this. It's all transparent, but the hardware then deals with all of this stuff going on in the background to ensure that your data is, again, redundant, recoverable, and as fast as is possible. But that's what dynamic disks are all about. They contain the information that would allow Windows to implement spanned, striped, mirrored, RAID in software without you needing to add anything else other than the hard disks you want to use to make it happen. As I said, chances are you have a basic disk, and that's fine. There's really no reason, unless you're already in some kind of a high production environment, there's really no reason to consider dynamic discs. But I know that the question comes up every time people look at Disk Manager, so that's what it all means. And, you know, if you're so inclined, it may be something to play with someday. I will tell you that I have never played with this myself. Someday, maybe, when I have time. But for now, basic's good enough for me too. For updates, for comments, for links related to this topic and more, visit askleo.com/14532. I'm Leo Notenboom, and this is askleo.com. Thanks for watching.